things. First of all, there's that handout over on the chair that is the instructions for online study images that I mentioned briefly before and are explained a little bit, I think, on the last page of the handout. When you get that, you'll see that it's rather complicated instructions. But the first thing you should do is fill out the last page and give that back to me or take it to the art department office out there. And you put the user's name and information on yourself on that, which is then, which I turn over to the person who is in charge of this online system for the study images. She enters it into the computer system for the department, and when that's all accomplished, you will be able then to access these images online. And it's a little unclear exactly how long that's going to take to do that, as quickly as possible, but hold off trying to access them until next week sometime. The woman said that she thinks it'll be done by next Monday so that they can be accessed, but it might maybe wait until Tuesday to make sure. Because if you try to access them before the information is put in, that can mess up something. I don't know. I should emphasize also that this these images, online images of the study slides, is not a requirement. You don't have to do this. It's simply an aid for studying that we instituted a couple of years ago, really largely at the request of students who wondered if there was some way that they could see some of these images. Most of the images, though, are illustrated in the reading, it's not something that you have to do, but if you want to, you can fill out those forms and return them to me and get this online access. About the textbooks. People pointed out to me that the textbooks ran out at the bookstore. I called them on Tuesday. They're reordering the Roth book, and the man told me that it should be ready next Tuesday, he said. So let me know if they still don't have enough or if they don't come in, keep me informed about that. The reader, as for the course reader that has all of the Xeroxes of the smaller weekly readings, those that you may know should just be ordered individually. In other words, if you don't have one of those and you want one, go to the bookstore and you put in your order, and I guess maybe pay for it, and then you come back and it says it's a 2-day turnaround. So that should clear up that problem, but we'll be informed if it doesn't. As for the weekly handouts, as you probably know, we're still on handout number one. So the next handout will be probably on Tuesday. And as I think I mentioned before, sometimes I'm not able to cover all of the material that's listed on those handouts. And in fact, this time on handout number one, there are some things that I've had to cut out of the lecture. Don't have time to include them all. So if something is listed on the handout, even if it has an asterisk on it, and if we do not discuss it in class, you can just more or less forget about it. Okay, let's have the first slides. Last time, as you remember, we were beginning to look at architecture in the English colonies in the 18th century. We saw that there were more ambitious urban plans that were being created, such as that for Williamsburg, Virginia, laid out right at the beginning of just around 1700 with axes and focal points. Type of plan reflecting here the axis of the main street in Williamsburg, with the Capitol, the college at the other end, and the governor's palace at this cross axis reflecting fashions in city planning in Europe of this period. And we saw that the architecture imitates, if only in a pale way in some cases, the latest fashions in upper class building in England as well. For example, this house on the right, Stratford, a house in Virginia built around 1730, with rather faint echoes of Baroque architecture, such as, and I compared it with the great Blenheim Castle, this huge house in England, where there are similar division into parts, so that the house is arranged into three major sections, a kind of courtyard suggested in the center, these chimneys banked together in a way to create a tower-like form that somewhat similar to those at Blenheim. And so this attempt to ape in some way on a smaller scale of fashions that were happening in England and Europe. Stratford, I should point out, this house on the right is an unusual example, maybe almost a unique example of this type of Baroque influence in America. More common influence is from Christopher Wren, the major architect in England around 1700, and specifically his parish churches that he built in London, many of them that he designed and built after the Great Fire of London in the 1660s. And here we see a slide that illustrates three of the towers on these parish churches, city churches as they were called in London. He designed dozens of these to replace all of the small parish churches in London that had been destroyed in the Great Fire. And he created a certain type of church building that was really his creation in some ways, drawing together various traditions. And particularly in the towers of these churches. Each one was slightly different, but as you can see in these three examples, what he's basically doing is building a tower out of different stages or parts, almost like a kind of wedding cake, but each part made up of elements that for the most part are classical. If you could see this in enough detail, you'd see that these are classical columns with the shaft and Ionic capitals, other columns or pilasters, these flattened out columns of pediments. In this case, it's a rounded pediment rather than a triangular one. But all of the basic elements are classical elements for the most part, some of them transformed, but then stacked on top of one another to create this vertical spire-like form that was a kind of focal point or indicated where these churches were. And this was really an innovation of Christopher Wren in these churches, but it became very popular in America for churches and for some other types of public buildings. And let's look at a couple of examples. Here's a church in Philadelphia. Christ Church, built in the 1730s. You can't see the church itself very well, but you see the tower, and that was part of the idea. These towers were meant to be prominent so that even if the church building itself was lost in the fabric of the city itself, that the towers would indicate very prominently where the churches were. And you can see that in a general kind of way, it's based on this Christopher Wren form of being built up out of stages, each one of which uses, to some extent, classical or semi-classical elements. It's not too close to any one of these three, but there's some other of Wren's churches, church towers that are actually closer to that Christ Church in Philadelphia on the left. Let's look at another example. This is not a church. This is the old Pennsylvania State House in Philadelphia, which later became called Independence Hall, and that's what is known today. It's where, of course, the Declaration of Independence was signed and other important things took place in the Revolutionary period. This was also begun in the 1730s, as the center of the colonial government for Pennsylvania. But you can see again that the tower is made up of these stages, the individual parts of which look like classical columns or pilasters. You can't really see them very well, but you can see in a general way how it's built up, these parts. The proportions of this are maybe not quite as carefully worked out or not as elegant as those of some other buildings, such as Christ Church or the prototypes in Wren's churches in London. There's something maybe a little awkward about the proportions, but it clearly comes from that tradition. I might point out that these buildings that we're looking at in the 18th century in the colonies are generally made of brick or wood, or sometimes a combination. The tower, as you can see, may be wood, and the rest of the bottom part brick, but usually not stone, as it would have been in England. All of those parish churches of Wren's and most other public important buildings in England or European cities would normally be made of stone, and so in the American colonies, this more common materials were used in these buildings, and the designs in general tended to be rather simplified. I should also mention that a term that one often hears in describing these buildings that we will be looking at today in the 18th century in the colonies, the term often used is Georgian, and you may run across that in the reading. It's really not. I tend to sort of avoid that term. I don't find it terribly useful, in that the word Georgian doesn't really tell us anything about the style of the building. It's one of these terms that's used in art history or in history for that simply is a period designation. It designates a period of time. Georgian being the period when the kings of England were the King Georges, of which there were several, of course, throughout the 18th century. So in that sense, it's like that term Jacobean in the previous century that referred to the King Jameses. And so it only tells us the period and really not too much about the style. But because during this period, there were a lot of different styles and things going on. But you may run across that term. Well, another kind of basic question about these buildings. Who were the architects of these colonial buildings? I haven't been mentioning architects' names. The fact is that architects, as we know them today, didn't really exist in colonial America. These buildings were mostly designed by what are sometimes referred to as carpenter builders, what today we would probably call a building contractor, the person who was actually in charge of building the building, and they would often be designed by these. And sometimes we don't know the names of these people. And they were not trained or particularly sophisticated in architecture, though some of them certainly were, but they generally drew their designs and took as sources engravings from books that came from England, and sometimes from other parts of Europe, but usually England. And the most popular of these books in America in the 18th century was one by an English architect named James Gibbs. It was called A Book of Architecture, and it was published in 1728, and was used throughout the rest of the 18th century as a source for designs for churches and houses and all sorts of buildings in the American colonies. And as a result, even though Gibbs was not as important an architect as Christopher Wren in England, it was really Gibbs' buildings, more than Wren's, that were often the sources for many of these American designs. And in fact, a good example is the church on the left there, Christ Church in Philadelphia. The tower is probably based on one of Gibbs's engraved designs, but especially the interior. Here we see the interior of Christ Church, and it's interesting to compare with a church in London of which I could only find a slide of this engraving of it. The church still exists. It's St. Martin's in the Fields in London. It was built in the early 18th century by Gibbs. But actually, this engraving maybe shows the details a little more clearly. And if we were to compare all of the parts and the elements of Christ Church on the right, we'd see that most of them come in some way transformed, sometimes simplified, from perhaps from this engraving. engraving or other similar engravings of this church by James Gibbs. I can't remember actually whether this particular engraving comes out of this book of his or was another engraving. But we can see that the galleries on the side are held up by these columns, which also support the central part of the structure of the building. Columns that have capitals at the top. These are Doric capitals. They're simpler than these Corinthian capitals in the church in London. So it was harder to do this in the colonies to do a Corinthian capital. So it was made Doric here, but it still has this unusual kind of block that's above the capital that was a kind of device that was typical of James Gibbs. It was just one of his little innovations that he liked to do. It sort of made the proportions taller and was an elegant little addition that he put there. So that's picked up in this church in Philadelphia. Then they support the arches above, and even the form of the window and behind the altar, this three of window with a circular section in the center and then two windows on the side, and we'll be seeing that form later. So in a basic way, it's the Philadelphia church is based on Gibbs's church, so everything's been simplified, especially the structure of the building, the domes, as you can see, or the vaults in the central part. It was too difficult to do these complex masonry vaults, so it was all simplified and made in wood in the American church. And let's look at another comparison that points out this importance of James Gibbs as a source and the kind of imitative nature of much of 18th century American architecture. This is another church. On the left, we actually see this church that we saw the interior of. This is St. Martin's in the Fields in Trafalgar Square in London, the exterior of it. That was designed by Gibbs in the early 18th century. And on the right, we see a church in Providence, Rhode Island, the Baptist Meeting House, built in the 1770s. And if you compare the towers in particular, you can see that that Gibbs's design is probably the source in a general sort of way for the building on the right, made up of these stages, and if you look at each one, the lower one, a square plan with a round window, then this one with arch openings on the side, and pilasters framing the arches, these flattened out columns, and then a pediment above that, another, the next stage up here that has sides that are cut off at a 45-degree angle, and you can see that it's similar to that, and then a kind of obelisk form at the top. So it seems clear that that's probably the source for it. But if you look at the church as a whole, you start seeing some differences. The church is not completely copied from Gibbs's church in London. And in fact, there's some odd or slightly, maybe even some slightly awkward or naive aspects. But do you notice anything? I want to get in the habit of looking at architecture carefully. And studying the images and comparing similar buildings. So let me just ask you to look at these for a minute. Do you see anything kind of odd or interesting about the church in Providence that you might point to? I don't have any particular one thing in mind, but I just want you to sort of start getting in the habit of observing things carefully. Do you have any observations? Yes.
Well, the tower... Providence is brought out to the front, so where it actually breaks the roof line that sort of is supposed to mimic a pediment, it's broken in the front, whereas in St. Martin's Field it's more in the back, and you look across the pediment as it is intended to be, or was intended to be, so on its own.
Okay, so here the tower seems to be, even though it's a little hard to see what's going on structurally back there, but it looks as though this is sitting back on the main part of the church, and then there's this pedimented portico is the technical name for this. It's like a temple front. This is the pediment part, the gable in the front, and this is the portico or porch with the columns. Is there anything like that
in the Providence Church. Does anyone else have any kind of observations? Yes.
It seems like the portico in the Providence Church is kind of like an afterthought, just kind of like a throwback, whereas in St. Martin's it's very much a part of the whole design.
Yeah, right, exactly. It's there. You've got a little pedimented portico, but it's almost like kind of a joke. It's sort of tacked on afterwards. It seems, as you say, sort of like an afterthought. And there's, in general, kind of awkwardness about the design. It certainly doesn't have the strength of this design. We're getting into areas that are now subjective, of course, more in the realm of architectural criticism, maybe, where we're talking about formal questions, whether things are integrated and all of that. And so all of this is a subjective area, but it's things that we should think about and have opinions on and be able to talk about these aspects. Certainly, it's not as sophisticated a design in terms of the principles of 18th century architecture. For a building like this, Gibbs designed this way so that the pedimented portico was large and was a prominent part of the building where you would enter the building and, in a sense, counterbalances the importance of the tower. Whereas here, the tower completely takes over, and this becomes almost like a afterthought, you pointed out. So it's not as well integrated, at least in the terms of 18th century architecture. And one of the reasons might just be because they didn't have enough money to make a large portico. Whenever you have large columns, especially if they were built out of stone, they were very expensive. Sometimes the most expensive part of a church or a large building like this. So it may have just been economic that they didn't want to do that. But they were willing to lavish a lot of attention on the tower. And again, I think it's because of the importance of towers for these buildings, especially in the colonies, maybe, and especially perhaps in a city that's near the coast or a port city, where the steeple of a church was important to be seen from the sea and had a kind of symbolic value. So there are these differences between the American building and the English prototype. Well, this church in Providence was designed by a man named Joseph Brown. We do know the name here, who was not one of these carpenter builders that I was describing, but he was an example of a different type of designer who was important in 18th century architecture. And it's sometimes called the gentleman architect. It was usually a man of the upper classes who was educated and interested in architecture simply as an avocation, not as a money-making profession that he needed to do the way a contractor or a carpenter builder would have to. It was something that was more of a hobby. And usually this person had a library of architectural books, such as James Gibbs's publications. The professional architect, as we know it today, did not really exist in the 18th century, at least not in America. There were the beginnings of the architectural profession in Europe, but in the colonies there really wasn't such a thing until well into the 19th century. So the people who designed these buildings usually fit into one of these two categories, the carpenter builder or the gentleman architect. And the most significant of the gentleman architects was probably a man named Peter Harrison, whose work I'd like to turn to now. And I listed him separately on that first handout because he's really, in some ways, he comes closest to being an architect in the modern sense. But he still was really one of these gentleman architects. He was a successful English merchant, but then he settled in Newport, Rhode Island, and was fascinated with architecture. And in the 1740s, he began designing buildings in Rhode Island primarily, but also in the Boston area. And he would move around, and that's one thing that made him a little different from these gentleman architects who usually would just design a building in the area where they lived. They would maybe be asked to design the church that they belonged to or design people's houses. But Harrison became very well known as a talented architect, and so he would be called to other parts of the colonies, such as Boston and other towns. But it was mainly in his native, or in Rhode Island, where he settled, that he
did his work. Now, again, he drew most of his designs from the designs in books, English books, of which he had a very good collection. But he also had his own direct knowledge of contemporary English architecture because he was a merchant and traveled back and forth from England to the colonies. Well, here we see one of his buildings. This happens to be in Boston. It's called King's Chapel, built in right around 1750, right in the middle of the century, and was an Anglican church. And this in itself is interesting because in the earlier part of the colonial period, New England was almost exclusively the dissenting denominations, of Puritans and so forth. And the Anglicans tended to be stronger in the South. But now by the middle of the 18th century, there were really, were no longer these religious distinctions, and the colonies in some ways were becoming more homogenous religiously than in other ways. Anyway, if we look at King's Chapel in Boston, we see a couple of interesting things. On the outside, it's this church, as you can see from the slide, is right down in downtown Boston and now surrounded by these tall buildings all around it, so not nearly as impressive as it would have been originally. Also, of course, it does not have that steeple that would have been on top of the tower. Originally, it was planned to have a steeple, but it never was built for some reason. I'm not sure exactly why. Another thing that you see here is the material. Now, this is made of stone. In the middle of the 18th century, building stone is beginning to be used in the American colonies. It's a more difficult material, has to be quarried, of course, and the masonry techniques are harder, but now starting to find stone buildings. The interior, again, seems to be based on Gibbs's Church of St. Martin's in the Fields in London. And in fact, if we were to get that engraving again and compare it, we'd see that in some ways it's closer to Gibbs's design, and there's more of an attempt to create the patterns of vaulting in the ceiling. Though it's still done in wood here on the inside of the church, even though that exterior we see is in stone. Let's look at a more unusual commission that Harrison got, or job that he did, which is a different kind of building that we haven't seen. Very interesting difference. This is a synagogue. And it's in Newport, Rhode Island, where Peter Harrison lived. He was asked to design this synagogue, which was actually the first synagogue in the English colonies. I believe that's so true. It was built in 1759 and is called the Touro Synagogue. I'm not sure exactly what it's named for, what the word Touro means, but that's the name of the synagogue. I should point out we're going to be seeing a number of buildings in Newport, Rhode Island, and you may be familiar with Newport as the great resort or summer colony for the super wealthy in the 19th and early 20th century. And so I should point out that we're looking at an earlier stage in the evolution of the town of Newport. In the 18th century, at this time when these buildings were built that we're seeing, it was not a resort for the super wealthy. It was just a regular seaport town in Rhode Island. And it was later in the 19th century that it took on this other character. So this was just, Newport was like any other seaport town. It was actually one of the most prosperous and active commercial centers in the colonies. Well, so I believe this was the first synagogue in the English colonies. And it's not surprising or perhaps accidental that it's in Rhode Island, because Rhode Island had more religious freedom than the other colonies, and as a result, a community of Sephardic Jews had settled there. There was no strong tradition of what synagogues in classical architecture should look like, or at least no tradition that Peter Harrison would have been aware of. And so he really had to come up with a design on his own, or maybe with the advice of the congregation. And he created a structure which really has more of a domestic character, at least from the outside. As you can see, that could be some kind of a house. It's more in the domestic tradition, with a large square space inside with the
pews in the various formations. And he created galleries for additional seating around the sides, with they were supported on columns, which, as you can see, are in the Ionic order. There are these three orders that I mentioned, Doric. If you've seen one of those, this is the Ionic that uses these, that has these spiral volutes on the corners, and then the Corinthian order is the most complex. And I have one more slide of the interior of the Touro Synagogue. This is the view of the tabernacle area. Not sure how clearly you can see the details there. We're here to the actual details of the carving, the classical elements of pilasters and pediments and so forth, are probably copied and drawn from these English books, such as the designs of gifts. So he's using the same sources, despite the fact that it's a synagogue. It fits into the same, he's trying to make it as much as possible part of the same classical English tradition. For example, you can see this pediment form, almost like a little temple, that frames the tablets of the Ten Commandments. But Harrison's most remarkable design was probably the next one I'd like to look at, which is a library, one of the first libraries, public, or one of the buildings that was specifically designed as a library in the colonies. This is also in Newport, built in 1748, again, right in the middle of the century. All of Harrison's work, these important designs of his, are all right around 1750. And it's called the Redwood Library, not because it's made out of redwood, but it was donated to the city of Newport by a man named Abraham Redwood, and was, in fact, one of the first public libraries in America, along with one that Benjamin Franklin organized in Philadelphia. I should point out that when we're looking at this building, the original part, the original library, is simply this front part here in the back. This was added later, so it's it may seem like a very small building, the original part just on the front, but in fact it was a major building in this library type that just hadn't existed in the colonies before. The most striking thing about the design architecturally is the large temple portico on the front. Again, one of these pedimented porticos that looks like a little temple on the front. And this was perhaps the first appearance of this form in America, at least on a large scale. There had been earlier cases like that, church in Providence, where there'd be a little portico by a doorway, but to have a large part of the building taking this form of a temple portico was something new in the colonies. And this type of use of the classical Roman temple portico had really just recently become popular in England. And it was one manifestation of a new attitude that is often called neoclassicism. And here's another term that you're going to run across in the readings and that one often hears about. It's another one of these terms can be a little vague, or it's a complex phenomenon. But for our purposes, I think it's probably enough to say that neoclassicism was largely a reaction against the complicated forms of the Baroque. We saw some of those Baroque buildings like Blenheim Castle, where everything gets very, very complex, and the classical forms of columns and pediments are transformed in all sorts of strange ways. Well, in the 18th century, in the middle of the 18th century, there was a very strong reaction against that throughout Europe, in different degrees in different countries, and a desire to return to the simpler, basic forms of ancient classical architecture, Greek but especially Roman architecture in the 18th century. The simple elements of classical architecture, such as the temple portico, the pediment with the columns supporting it. However, I should mention here that designs like this, the
Harrison Ridley Library, we're usually not based directly on any ancient Roman building. Harrison, it's unclear how much Harrison even really knew about real Roman and Greek architecture. Rather, these buildings had their sources in the work of Renaissance architects who had revived the architecture of antiquity, but in the process, of course, changed it also. And especially, and one of the most important sources in the Renaissance for English and the American colonial architects was an architect named Palladio, Andrea Palladio, whose name I wrote on the board because I had neglected to write it out on the handout this week. And Palladio's influence was very strong in England at this time in the 18th century. And in this particular case of the building we're looking at now, it's been shown, apparently, there's been some research done, it's been shown that Harrison based the design of this building on an engraving from an English book of Palladio's writings. There were lots of editions of Palladio. Palladio had written a book called the Quattro Libri, the Four Books of Architecture, and it became very popular and was reproduced. I'll tell you more about the influence of Palladio a little later, his influence in America. But first I'd like to show now some examples of 18th century domestic architecture in America. So far today we've been looking, I guess, just at churches and these other public buildings. Let's look at some houses and see how they differ from the earlier 17th century houses that we looked at last time. Here we see on the right a lavish upper class house, and on the left a more a modest house. But just about from the same time, right? From the middle of the 18th century. Just about everything I think that we will be looking at today is from the mid 18th century. On the right we see a house called the Longfellow House. It's in Cambridge, Massachusetts, built around 1760. It's called the Longfellow House because the poet Longfellow actually lived in it, but later in the 19th century. He was a 19th century writer. This was originally built by somebody else, but because Longfellow was so famous, it's usually called the Longfellow House. It's, as you can see, a very large house, larger than houses that existed really for the most part in the 17th century. Has a rather formal arrangement of the rooms inside. I could not find a slide of the floor plan to show you, but basically what the plan would be in any one of this type of house in the 18th century would be that there'd be a central hall that you would enter in the center that sometimes would run completely through the house, and then there'd be a door on at the back. And then on either side there'd be suites of rooms, two or more rooms on the side, that would all have fireplaces. Of course, any house like this would have fireplaces in all the major rooms. And you can see that there are two large chimneys now, in contrast to the single chimney that was more typical in those houses we saw in the 17th century. That would be the chimneys for the several fireplaces that would be in these rooms on the suites on the side. So it's rather a formal, symmetrical arrangement of the rooms inside. And the facade is divided, as you can see, at least formally in a visual kind of way, into three parts. The house itself is a very square form, but nevertheless, the front is designed to give the sense that the central part steps out, and the house is divided into three parts. If you remember that house Stratford, where it actually did have three parts where the center was stepped in, there the plan actually had three completely separate parts. Here the plan is square, but there's an attempt to make it look as though it's more complex than that, with this central section, which actually projects a little bit, but just a tiny bit, a few inches, maybe 6 inches. You can tell from that the shadow that's cast down here where that part steps out. And this central part, to emphasize it and make it seem more important, is given a pediment at the top, and then it's supported below by these pilasters. You remember that form of a kind of flattened out column that actually has the capital of the column here. It's an Ionic of pilaster, and these are on the corners of the building as well to kind of give it a
classical aspect, obviously an attempt by the middle class here, or the by the designer of the Longfellow House, to refer to classicism and to make this house part of the classical tradition and to link it to buildings and designs in England, even though we don't have full-fledged columns here. But then I think it's interesting to compare it to the house on the left, a much more typical house of the period. This is in Sturbridge Village in Massachusetts. It actually, I think, was moved there by from somewhere else. Sturbridge Village is a kind of historical place where they brought together a lot of colonial houses, and it's a study center and visited. They recreated life of the colonial period, sort of like Williamsburg in Virginia, this in Massachusetts. But this house was built around 1750, apparently, and was probably the house of a middle-class craftsman or a successful farmer. The basic form of the house is more or less the same as those 17th century houses, that New England houses that we saw, like the Parson Cavan house and Connecticut. It even has this kind of salt box form with a little addition on the back there, and the single chimney, as you can see. So the one chimney that comes down in the center of the house to retain heat and would serve all the rooms around it. It's a little bigger, maybe, than some of those 17th century houses, or the typical one. The windows are bigger, certainly. That's a difference. By this time, they did not need, the heat retention was not so important that they didn't have to have tiny little windows. Also, glass was being more readily manufactured and was more available, so the windows could be bigger. But what's interesting here, I think, is that even though the basic form of the house is traditional and typical in this way, there are attempts to bring it up to date, and even if only in a kind of timid sort of way or a minimal way. Around the doorway, you can see here, or maybe it's a little hard for you to see, but these are very simple pilasters, these flattened out columns with even have a little simple capital at the top. And then there are some classical type forms of carving in a simple way above the doorway. So it's an attempt to give it a classical form around the doorway. And in fact, at the corners of the house itself are these boards, which may not look like pilasters, they don't have any capitals on it at the top, but in fact, I think that's what the motive was. It was an attempt to make it look like the pilasters that one would find on a lavish upper class house. So it's an attempt by the by this class of the tradesmen, craftsmen, or well-to-do farmer class to be up to date and to imitate to some extent the fashions of the wealthy. And I think we might suggest that this is a kind of American characteristic. Styles that quite quickly filter down from the upper class to the rest of society, even if they become very simplified. And it's a different pattern, I think, from the traditional situation in Europe, where the aristocratic styles of architecture tended to be more exclusively for the upper classes, and it tended to be much more of a distinction between the house types or the architecture of the different classes, which of course were much more stratified and established than in America. We'll see more examples of this phenomenon in American architecture in future periods, but I think it's interesting to think about and suggests a more fluid state of society, or upward mobility, we might say, perhaps a more democratic function. That's maybe exaggerating a bit. I don't want to overgeneralize or exaggerate, but I think it's still an interesting point to think about. Let's look now at another mid-18th century house. This in the south. This is in Charleston, South Carolina, also from the 1760s. You can see the population was growing a lot in these 2 decades right before the American Revolution, and so there's just a lot of building going on, a lot of more prosperity, and that's why we see so many buildings from this period in the 1750s and 60s. This is called the Miles Bruton House, And here we see another feature that we haven't really seen in domestic architecture in America, that pedimented portico, now used for a house, a full pedimented portico with the actual columns, not just interpreted in with pilasters. And in fact, here, it's built on two levels, as you can see, one on top of another. For the origin of this feature, at least in domestic architecture, I have to say something more now about that 16th century Italian architect, Andrea Palladio, who designed villas in the area around Venice in northern Italy, in which he made several important innovations. And we can't go into this in detail, since we're interested in America now, not Italian Renaissance architecture, but it's important to understand what's happening in America. Here we see, and also just fun to look at, some of Palladio's work. It's often called Palladian architecture, and that's the adjective which is used for Palladio. Here we see one of these villas that he designed outside the town of Vicenza. This one's called the Villa Rotonda, built in the later part of the 16th century. And here, Palladio applied the temple portico to domestic architecture. In fact, as you can see here, he puts a little temple portico on all four sides of this the house, which has a little dome in the center. Makes it look very important and imposing and impressive, but in fact, it really was just the country house of a well-to-do farmer. And so it's a type of house that there was nothing really special about the function of the house. What is important here is that Palladio made an innovation, and this had really never been done before, of applying to essentially a relatively simple or straightforward country house of the middle classes architectural elements like pedimented porticos and domes that make them much grander and more imposing than they really were, and gave them a kind of status. It was a kind of status symbol to have and this became very popular, and all sorts of people in this area around Venice started building these country houses that suddenly started looking like temples or palaces or government buildings. So it was a kind of status seeking. Well, in the early 18th century, this is now one and a half centuries later, after they were built, English noblemen and their architects began visiting Italy and rediscovered Palladio, took his ideas back to England, where they became popular for country houses in England. And it soon spread to the American colonies. So that's how these forms get to America. And let's look at another somewhat smaller villa by Palladio. This is, again, in this area around Vicenza in northern Italy, that was probably the specific source of the Bruton house that we see on the right there. Many of these villas by Palladio were engraved, and either in his own books, like the Quattro Libri, or in English versions of these books, he became very popular. It's often called the Palladian movement in architecture in the 18th century. Very important in England, and then transferred to America, as you can see. Let's look at actually one of these plates from Palladio's book, the Quattro Libri. Here's one of the actual pages from his book that shows another one of his innovations. We see one of these country houses of his that has the temple front on it. But more interesting here, or what I want to point out, is the plan of the overall house. Here we see the building itself, but then there are these subsidiary wings connected to the house by curving colonnades. And this was really an innovation of Palladio's. This is, again, essentially a country house, a wealthy farmer's house. And these extra parts, which are attached to the main house, are the outbuildings that one would need to run any kind of a farm. The stables and kitchens and storerooms and servants' rooms, but by which in traditional country houses would have maybe been separate buildings or would have been behind the building in a kind of courtyard around the house. But Palladio arranges them in this very symmetrical grand pattern to create a grand overall arrangement that makes the whole more than the sum of the parts, and again gives it more status and makes it look like something much more important than it really is. Well, this became also very popular in 18th century architecture in England and also in America. This arranging the parts of a house with subsidiary or side wings connected sometimes with curving colonnades. And though one tends to find it only in the most lavish and upper class houses necessarily, because it involves, it makes the whole design and plan of these houses much more complicated. But let's look at a couple of examples quickly. Here's the plan of a house in Virginia called Mount Airy that is also from the 1750s. You can really think of just about everything we're looking at today is in this period right before the Revolution. And you can see in the plan that this that it was probably inspired by a one of these engraved plans of a building by Palladio or an English building based on it, with the house itself, and you can see this plan with the central hallway and suites of rooms on the sides, connected with curving wings to buildings, these pavilions, subsidiary pavilions that would have included the kitchen and other kinds of service parts of the building. I think I have a slide of this house itself, Mount Airy in Richmond County, Virginia. We don't see the side wings because they're obscured by the foliage there. I might also point out about the house itself. Now we're seeing houses made out of real stone. In this case, dark sandstone and light limestone, unusual for America, but again, picking up on more complex forms of building from Europe. And in this case, we know that the source of this particular house was a design from that book by Gibbs. So we're finding influences from all sorts of directions, from Palladio, from Gibbs and Rand and so forth. But you can see how dependent it is on England and European architecture. One other such house, this house in Philadelphia, or outside Philadelphia, called Mount Pleasant, again built at the same time, around 1760. One of the grandest American houses of this period in the 18th century. These little wings, originally probably connected by colonnades for the house, the chimneys banked together in that way that remind us a bit of Stratford, this a window form, which is actually called a Palladian window, you know, with these central part, the curving part in the center, and then two square headed windows on the sides, and other details that we get to point out if we have time. Well, one other slide of the interior of this house, of the hallway on the second floor. Again, the plan of this house would be a central hallway below, the suites of rooms on the side, and even on the second floor, there was a smaller central hallway that sometimes would be used for various entertaining purposes. Well, houses of this type were found throughout the colonies in the later 18th century. There's a kind of architectural uniformity developing, at least in the upper classes of society, like the kind of people who could build this sort of house. But not everything was uniformly based on English prototypes. There were certain regional styles of architecture that were developed, and let me just suggest one of these is some completely different type of house. We're still talking about the upper middle classes or upper classes, but here we see a type of house that became common in the South, and particularly in Charleston, South Carolina, with a type of house with that was more used in the center of the city where there was less room. These weren't country houses, as you can see, they're along streets. And the narrow side of the house is on the street, and on the southern side, usually, is this long porch or series of porches that to shade the sun and allow for sitting outside in the summer. This was either a transformation of the classical portico, the classical porch, and making it into a more functional form, or as suggested by that person John Block I talked about last time, it possibly had an African or Caribbean source or influence. But in any case, it reveals an American tendency, I think, to innovate and to transform European patterns in all sorts of interesting ways. And I'd like to conclude our look at domestic architecture of this period by looking again at the house that we saw briefly last time, I think, Mount Vernon in Virginia, with its own version of this idea of a long porch, or the term that's often used in the South is the word piazza. At least in Charleston, at these houses, they call these porches on the side are called piazzas, which I've never quite understood why that term is used. It's not, of course, what piazza really means in Italian. But so here we have a different version of a long porch at Mount Vernon in Virginia. And I'd like to look at this house in a little more detail now. There's some interesting things about it. This, of course, is the home of George Washington. It was built starting in the 1750s and built in stages. The original house was enlarged several times. And let's look at another slide, view of the other side of the house, which is actually the entrance side where the road leads up to the house on this side, and then there are these colonnades, and you see them over there that connect with subsidiary buildings on the side, so it's part of that tradition. And then this is the garden side, the side that looks down to the Potomac rivers in northern Virginia, just close now to Washington, D.C. Well, let me ask you again to look at this house and to sort of analyze it or to observe things, and in particular, this side of the house, because there's some interesting and kind of strange things going on here. What's wrong with the house, I might say, or what's awkward about it? Do you want to, do you have any ideas? Yes?
I just have a more general question.
Okay.
Why were the builders of this time, the architects of this time, valuing such inconsistent designs?
Inconsistent in what way?
In pulling, just extrapolating from the Greek forms and kind of superimposing them over sheds, decorated sheds. How do they see the value of decorated sheds? I mean, to me, it looks silly, but...
Okay, when I should point out for the youth not familiar with this term, when you refer to decorated shed, it's a term that comes out of a contemporary architect named Robert Venturi and a book that he wrote several years ago. We'll actually get to Venturi later in the course. This is an interesting and kind of complicated question you raised, but there's no simple answer to it, I think. There were these... architect, you've got to remember the complex state of different types of people who were designing these houses. Some were these carpenter builders, gentlemen architects. They were obviously wanted to be up to date as much as possible with what was happening in England, but conditions were different in America, as I've been trying to show. And so it's complicated with that they were pulling all these things together. And
seems like the blind leading the blind.
Well, maybe in some ways, right? And some of this, I think, we can see, especially the kind of the blind or naive aspects of it, maybe, by looking at this facade of Mount Vernon. What kinds of things do you notice here? Yes.
It looks like they're trying to do the three different parts, but it's not brought forward at all. So the triangle in the middle is just stuck on there without even.
Right. There's clear. Here's this pediment form to make it look kind of like a temple, maybe. But what's kind of wrong with that? Yeah. As you say, it just kind of looks stuck on. Yeah, anything else?
Kind of like they measured wrong.
Okay. Okay, it's not really symmetrical, too. Yeah.
Yeah, it's what I'm going to point out. The windows aren't even equal across the front.
Yeah, they don't quite line up here. And I don't No, as you can see, you know, they don't really work.
Right.
It's not symmetrical. It's not only a problem of it not being symmetrical, but if this is a pediment, that suggests that there should be something underneath kind of holding it up, either columns or pilasters maybe, and one of them might be over here. But there aren't any, so it's just kind of floating there. But if there were going to be one, you could maybe have one here, but you couldn't have one there because the window's in the way. So they just don't quite work right. It's sort of illogical. And in this case, I don't know exactly the reasons for this. I think it's probably because this house was built in stages, as I say. They maybe needed to have the rooms in a certain places inside, and it just, or maybe this pediment was added later. I don't know enough about the actual stages of how it was built. And so it just kind of didn't work out right. But what's interesting is there's this attempt to give it a pretentious quality, give it a classical kind of sense, even though there's no hope of doing it right. It's from any classical architect would have just thought this was kind of a joke, all of these funny asymmetries and nothing really working out. Were there any other kind of observations anyone wanted to make?
Well, it seems like for the size and the elaborateness of the house, the front door is ridiculously small and
No. And again, it doesn't have, if this was really done like some of those little more sophisticated designs we've seen, there would have been something more prominent about the front door. Also, there's some other funny things going on here. The more you look at it, the weirder this house starts looking. It has these side of semicircular passageways to connect it to the pavilions at the side, but they're not connected to the house the way they should be. And I think I may have another slide that shows that a little better. What slide is this? Side is this on? It's here. Yeah. Look at that. Normally, if you had one of these galleries, the passageways that connected to the house, it either would connect right into the side of the house, or it might be separated out in front. But this is sort of halfway in between. It just doesn't connect quite right, and they have to build this little piece of wall there. So again, it's awkward. It's just not done right. There clearly was no real architect in charge of this whole thing from the beginning. It was kind of piecemeal. So it's very naive, certainly from a European or properly architectural point of view. And then you get this funny, this window here. This is completely proper. This is one of these Palladian windows, and in fact, it's very sophisticated in its design. All of the parts, it's got a broken pediment here, and it's the latest kind of fashion in a Palladian window, but it's just kind of stuck on the side of this building, almost like on the side of a barn kind of thing. And so so there are these conflicting of inconsistent things going on here. On the one hand, an attempt to be sophisticated and correct on the one hand, but that it doesn't really, they can't really pull it off. It's naive or not really, doesn't really work. And so maybe we could say there's something American about this as well. The desire to be both sophisticated but also at the same time a willingness to be simple and rural and kind of naive. It's a fascinating example just to look at. One more slide of Mount Vernon, one of the interior rooms. This, in fact, is the room right behind this wall here. That's the dining room, I believe. And here we see that very fashionable Palladian window. The interiors reflect thoroughly contemporary fashion in England at the time. The designs of the Adam brothers and others. So it's that desire to ape the sophistication of the English upper class. One thing that's interesting, just parenthetically, is that Mount Vernon was restored recently. They did a very careful study of taking the paint, for example, on the walls back to the original and figuring out what how the room was decorated originally. And there were some surprises. They found that the original colors of the walls were much brighter than people thought they had been in the colonial period. Brighter than this. This is a slide from the earlier state of the house, and now they've found that there were very bright colors used. They even seem kind of jarring to us today. Anyway, Mount Vernon is a fascinating house, not because it was the home of George Washington, our first president, not because it reveals these
strange and in some ways contradictory aspects of upper class architecture of the colonial period. Well, next week we'll look at architecture following the revolution, but in the remaining time today, I thought I would give a very brief survey of colonial American colleges. And this is something that I have a special interest in myself, and I've written something, some things about. And so I, even though we can't really pay much attention to it or spend much time, I wanted to at least be able to say something about it. And it will give it a little background for things that we'll be looking at later in the quarter, including the architecture there at Stanford. Well, on the left we see an example of a typical English college from the late medieval or Renaissance period. This is Brasenose College at Oxford. And it is a good example of the type of the English quadrant. The college buildings built around often a very small quadrangle and in this very closed-in kind of way, focusing in to the center, to the quadrangle, almost kind of shutting the exterior world outside. And it's really, and it's based on the tradition of medieval monasteries with their cloisters. And that's really what this these colleges in many ways grew out of the monastic tradition. Well, the early colonists in America, starting in the 17th century, were familiar with this English tradition of colleges. Some of them had attended Oxford or Cambridge. And when colleges started to be founded in America, starting with Harvard in 1636, they naturally were drawing on these traditions from Oxford and Cambridge. But what's interesting is that right from the beginning, in the earliest stages of the early buildings at Harvard, for example, here we see three of the earliest Harvard buildings. This is an engraving that was made in the beginning of the 18th century, but most of these buildings went back to the 17th century. There's a difference. They're already making an innovation and departing from the English monastic tradition of colleges. And here we see another view of Harvard later, toward the end of the 18th century. It's actually an engraving that was made by Paul Revere. And these three buildings are here. Actually, by this time, this building was replaced by this one, but they've added two more buildings over here. And the point that I would want to make is that if these builders of Harvard and the American colleges had wanted to follow the English tradition, they could easily have located these new buildings to create an enclosed quadrangle in the English tradition, but they didn't. They create a new pattern of buildings which open out much more. It's a more extroverted notion of opening to the world and of not having this introverted, closed-in kind of quadrangle. And there are possible reasons for this. A number of possible reasons. One would be the rejection of the monastic tradition, being coming from a Puritan tradition. They just didn't want to do anything that suggested monasteries, or that there was a more a sense of belonging more to the community and being open to the community. Also, possibly a response to the American landscape, that the vastness of the American landscape suggested that these new colleges should open up to it, and that there's more of a desire to open up to the outside world. For whatever the reason, this becomes a basic aspect of American colleges from then on, and even up to today, that are much more open and opening out to the world. And in fact, it becomes an American characteristic to build colleges out in nature, not even having them in the center of cities, the way they almost always have been in England and Europe. And so some American colleges, even starting in the colonial period, were actually founded out in the wilderness, not in a town, the way Harvard was in Cambridge. And here we see an early engraving, a kind of romanticized later image of the founding of Dartmouth College in New Hampshire, which was actually
founded out in the wilderness, and it was done on purpose, partly because it was a desire to be a missionary school to contact with the Indians. And there are all sorts of other interesting aspects about this that relate to the American experience. But the fact is, it's an example of a college being founded in the wilderness that becomes a kind of American characteristic. Then we see on the left Williamsburg that we've looked at before, and I just wanted to point out that the college is up here, and here's an early engraved view of the buildings at Williamsburg, the so-called Wren Building in the center that some people thought was designed by Christopher Wren, but probably wasn't, with these two buildings on the side. Again, they could have been located very close together around to create an enclosed quadrangle, but it's much more open and relates to the town as being the focal point for the axial character of the urban plan of Williamsburg. So there's much more. These American colleges, right from the beginning, are much more relating to the community and as a whole and the outside world. And this really becomes an American characteristic. It's a view of this building at Williamsburg. One more example of one of the early American colleges, about 7 or 8 of them founded by the time of the American Revolution. This Princeton with another somewhat different pattern. The main building here, Nassau Hall, really included all of the college functions. This was the president's house over here, but the college itself, including the dormitory where the students lived, all the classrooms, the chapel, the library, everything was in one building. And this became another pattern in American collegiate tradition. So there was a great variety in innovative forms used right from the beginning. One more, somewhat different pattern. This is Yale, which was also founded in the colonial period in New Haven, Connecticut. The buildings, built in stages, but lined up in a row here, facing the New Haven green. Again, in this very extroverted kind of way, looking out to the community and the world outside. And finally, if we jump ahead in time and think about how this might relate to Stanford, here we see the original architect's drawing for the quad, designed in 1888 with the tower, with the original church, with the original tower that came down in the earthquake, as did the Memorial Arch here. I hope we'll have time later to look at this story. And of course, the aerial view of Stanford. To some extent, I think the Stanford campus here combines many of these various traditions from American campus planning. It's built around a quadrangle, of course, but it's not like those tight, enclosed English quadrangles. There's also an openness, and especially an openness to nature. And it's very setting, the fact that that Stanford was built out in nature, in the farmland, in this beautiful setting where we're aware of the hills around us, is part of that American connection of colleges with seeing them in nature and as part of the world. So, well, when we pick up next time, we'll look at architecture for a new nation after the following American Revolution. Thank you.